2nd Canadian Division during World War II, Wikipedia article audio. The 2nd Canadian Division, an infantry division of the Canadian Army, was mobilized for war service on September 1, 1939 at the outset of World War II. Adopting the designation of the 2nd Canadian Infantry Division, it was initially composed of volunteers within brigades established along regional lines, though a halt in recruitment in the early months of the war caused a delay in the formation of brigade and divisional headquarters. With questions concerning overseas deployment resolved, the division's respective commands were formed in May and June 1940, and at British Prime Minister Winston Churchill's request, the division was deployed to the United Kingdom between August 1 and December 25, 1940, forming part of the Canadian Corps. Having performed well in training exercises during 1941 and early 1942, elements of the 2nd Division were selected as the main force for Operation Jubilee, a large-scale amphibious raid on the port of Dieppe in German-occupied France. On August 19, 1942, with air and naval gunfire support, the division's 4th and 6th Infantry Brigades assaulted Dieppe's beaches. The Germans were well prepared and, despite being reinforced, the Canadians sustained heavy losses and had to be evacuated, with fewer than half their number returning to the United Kingdom. Following a period of reconstruction and retraining from 1942 to 1944, the division joined IA Canadian Corps as part of the British 2nd Army for the Allied invasion of Normandy. The 2nd Division saw significant action from July 20 to August 21 in the battles for Seine and Falaise. Joining the newly activated headquarters of the 1st Canadian Army in the assault on northwestern Europe, the 2nd Canadian Infantry Division played a significant role in the retaking of the Channel ports, the Battle of the Scheldt, and the liberation of the Netherlands. The division was deactivated shortly after the end of the war. At the start of the Second World War, the Canadian Active Service Force was initially composed of two divisions, the 1st and 2nd Canadian Infantry Divisions, both raised on September 1, 1939. The fighting power of this force lay in its constituent infantry brigades, of which each division had three. These were in turn composed of three rifle and one machine gun battalion, with additional divisional artillery and engineer units in support. Formed under the command of Major General Victor Odlum with an authorized strength of between 13,000 and 17,000 personnel, the 2nd Canadian Infantry Division, like its sister formation, was originally organized along regional lines. Its 4th Brigade was composed of regiments from Ontario, the 5th Brigade of regiments from Quebec, and 6th Brigade of regiments from Western Canada. These were the same infantry brigades, although their constituent battalions were different, that had formed part of the 2nd Canadian Division during its service on the Western Front as part of the Canadian Expeditionary Force during the First World War. It was over a year before the 2nd Division came together as a cohesive unit and, during the interim period between formation and arrival in the United Kingdom, many changes to its organization were made. The 1st Brigade concentrations took place in May and June 1940, until which time all units had trained in their own garrisons. The 4th Brigade assembled at Camp Borden in Ontario, the 5th at Valcartier Camp in Quebec, and the 6th at Camp Shiloh in Manitoba. The divisional artillery was concentrated at artillery training centers at Camp Petoraa in Ontario, and at Shiloh. The 2nd Division structure was altered in early 1940, reducing its number of machine gun battalions from 3 to 1. The Camerons and the Chaudiers were reassigned to the newly mobilized 3rd Canadian Infantry Division, and the Winnipeg Grenadiers were sent to Jamaica for garrison duty, after which they returned to Canada then redeployed to Hong Kong, where they were captured when it fell to the Japanese on December 25, 1941. In May 1940, the Black Watch were moved from Valcartier to Newfoundland, and in June, the 2nd Division was earmarked for garrison duty by the forces of the British Commonwealth, with the Royal Regiment of Canada and Le Fusiliers Mont Royal arriving in Iceland later that month. However, at the request of Winston Churchill, these deployments were cut short, as the division was badly needed in England to supplement the British Army, then facing the imminent possibility of German invasion. As a result, most of the 2nd Division's units were sent to the United Kingdom in August 1940, although the Iceland garrison remained in place until October 31. The absence of the Mont Royals allowed Odlum to reassign the Calgary Highlanders to the 5th Brigade in September, in an attempt to ethnically mix the brigades of the division. By late December 1940, the 2nd Canadian Division was joined with the 1st to form the Canadian Corps. In 1941, the Toronto Scottish Regiment was transferred from the 1st Division to become the Machine Gun Battalion of the 2nd Division. Around the same time, the 8th Reconnaissance Regiment was raised from 2nd Division personnel supplemented by reinforcements from Canada. Due to equipment shortages, it was often difficult to adequately supply newly arrived divisions in England. Artillery units had to make use of outmoded 75mm guns with steel tires, and a lack of anti-aircraft guns, diverted to civil defense during the height of the Battle of Britain, left Canadian units to fend for themselves with small arms. However, by February 1941, enough Bren guns had been issued to the infantry units and, by September, the artillery had been equipped with 25-pounder howitzers, although signals equipment and transport were still lacking and anti-tank guns were dangerously scarce. When the division was not engaged in coastal defense duties or unit training, formation-level training took the form of increasingly larger exercises. Exercise Waterloo, conducted from June 14 to 16, 1941, was the largest in the United Kingdom to date, with I Canadian Corps counterattacking an imagined German sea and air landing. Exercise Bumper, held from September 29 to October 3, was larger still, involving 250,000 men. These exercises tended to concentrate on traffic control, communications, and logistical concerns, and were of little practical value to the infantry. On December 23, 1941, Major General Harry Crerar was appointed as divisional commander, replacing Odlin, who had ceased command in November, temporarily handing over to Major General John Roberts. However, Crerar was appointed temporary corps commander the same day and as a result never actually fulfilled the role of divisional commander, with Roberts eventually being confirmed in the role in April 1942. Meanwhile, on December 30, 1941, the Calgary Highlanders introduced battle drill to the division. This new type of training emphasized small unit tactics as well as hardening training through use of live ammunition, slaughterhouse visits, and obstacle courses, and was adopted throughout Commonwealth forces stationed in Britain. In early 1942, under Roberts, the 2nd Canadian Infantry Division participated in several additional full-scale combat exercises, again gauging the ability of Commonwealth divisions to repel a possible German invasion. As April and May progressed, the exercises intensified, becoming significantly more demanding on the participants. As a result, the 2nd Division was judged to be one of the four best divisions in the United Kingdom, and was selected as the primary force for the upcoming Allied attack on the German-occupied port of Dieppe, codenamed Operation Jubilee. Mounted as a test of whether or not such a landing was feasible, the Dieppe raid was to be undertaken by the 4th and 6th Brigades, with additional naval, air, and infantry support. Significant elements of the 5th Brigade were also involved. On August 19, 1942, while British commando units attacked bunker positions on the outskirts of Dieppe, forces of the 2nd Division landed on four beaches. The easternmost, Blue Beach, which was situated at the foot of a sheer cliff, presented the most difficulties. The Royal Regiment of Canada, with a company of the Black Watch, was held at bay by two platoons of German defenders. Only 6% of the men that landed on Blue Beach returned to Britain. The main beaches, codenamed White and Red, lay in front of Dieppe itself. Making only minor gains, the majority of the 4th and 6th Brigades became pinned down on the beach, and despite the arrival of an armored squadron from the Calgary Tank Regiment, casualties were heavy. Reinforcements from the Mont Royals had little effect, and surviving forces were withdrawn by 11 o'clock. Of the nearly 5,000 Canadian troops that participated, more than half were killed, wounded or captured. At Green Beach to the west, part of the South Saskatchewan Regiment was landed on the wrong side of the Sea River, necessitating an assault over the machine gun swept bridge there so they could assault the cliffs on the west. The village of Pourville was captured, but the eastern cliffs proved impossible to capture, so blocking their assault on an artillery battery and a radar station. The Queen's Own Cameron Highlanders were landed with the objective of moving south to attack an airfield and a divisional HQ. Neither battalion was able to achieve their objectives. As with the other three beaches, casualties among the Canadians were high with 160 fatalities. Throughout 1943, The 2nd Division focused on rebuilding its ranks, having lost close to half its strength at Dieppe. In April 1943, Major General Guy Simons assumed command of the division, taking over from Roberts, before handing over the following month to Major General Edson Burns. In January 1944, Major General Charles Foulkes, the first officer to command the division who had not served in the Great War, replaced Burns. The following month, all three brigade commanders were replaced as part of a general move to modernize the Canadian Forces' higher echelons, further sweeping changes throughout all levels of command, coupled with the lingering effects of the large influx of new personnel during 1943, lowered morale in the division. However, in March 1944, training again intensified, heralding the coming invasion of Europe. On March 9, the 2nd Division was inspected by King George VI, and by May the division numbered close to 18,000 fully equipped and trained soldiers. When D-Day arrived on June 6, 1944, the main Canadian assault was led by the 3rd Canadian Infantry Division, while the 2nd Division was held in reserve. At this time, the division consisted of three brigades, 4th, 5th and 6th, each of three infantry battalions, and a brigade ground defense platoon provided by Lorne Scots. In addition, at divisional level there was a machine gun battalion and a reconnaissance regiment provided by the Toronto Scottish Regiment and 8th Reconnaissance Regiment, as well as various combat support and service support elements including field, anti-tank and anti-aircraft artillery, field engineers, electrical and mechanical engineers, and signals, medical, ordnance, service corps troops and provosts. The attack on Juno Beach by the 3rd Canadian Infantry Division was the most successful of the five beaches attacked on D-Day, June 6, 1944. Having successfully landed in Normandy, Allied forces soon became embroiled in battles against German armor and were unable to significantly expand their beachhead. By the time the 2nd Division came ashore at the end of the first week of July, the entire front had congealed. Assigned to the II Canadian Corps, and subordinated to the British 2nd Army, the division assembled its brigades for combat while British and Canadian forces launched Operation Charnwood. It was a tactical success, but could not clear all seen of its German defenders. Although originally a D-Day objective, Seine proved a difficult prize, holding out until July 19 when it finally fell to British troops during Operation Goodwood. In the aftermath, General Bernard Montgomery, commander of the Anglo-Canadian 21st Army Group, ordered elements of II Canadian Corps, commanded by Lieutenant General Guy Simons, to push forward towards Verrier's Ridge, the dominant geographical feature between Seine and Falaise. By keeping up the pressure, Montgomery hoped to divert German attention away from the American sector to the west. Operation Atlantic, launched on July 18 alongside Goodwood, had the objectives of securing the western bank of the Orne River and Verrier's Ridge. The 2nd Division's 5th and 6th Brigades were selected as the assaulting forces, with the 5th Brigade focusing on the Orne and the 6th on Verrier's. The 4th Brigade were tasked with securing the flank of the operation, and the Royal Regiment of Canada attacked Louvigny on July 18. Early on July 19, the Calgary Highlander seized Point 67, directly north of Verrier's Ridge, and the following morning the Royal Highland Regiment of Canada crossed the Orne River and secured the flanks of the advance. In the afternoon, the 6th Brigade South Saskatchewan Regiment attacked the well-entrenched German positions on the ridge, with support from Typhoon fighter bombers and tanks. However, the attack ran into torrential rain, and the Germans counterattacked in force. This and further German attacks inflicted heavy casualties on the South Saskatchewan Regiment and its supporting battalions, the Essex Scottish Regiment and the Queen's Own Cameron Highlanders of Canada. On July 21, the 5th Canadian Infantry Brigade reinforced Canadian positions on Point 67. In 2 days of fighting, the division suffered 1,349 casualties. On July 22, 1944, Montgomery elected to use the Anglo-Canadian forces south of Seine in an all-out offensive aimed at breaking the German defensive cordon and keeping his forces bottled up in Normandy. To meet Montgomery's objectives, General Simons was ordered to design a large breakout assault, codenamed Operation Spring. The attack was planned in three tightly timed phases of advance, pitting two Canadian and two British divisions against three German SS Panzer divisions, which would be launched in conjunction with an American offensive, Operation Cobra, scheduled to take place on July 25, 1944. The 4th Brigade attacked in the east with some success, taking Verrier's village itself, but were repulsed at Tilly La Campagne by German counterattacks. The 5th Brigade, in the center, made a bid for Fontenay-lès-Marmion. Of the 325 members of the Black Watch who left the starter lines, only 15 answered evening roll call. German counterattacks on 26 and July 27 pushed Canadian forces back to Point 67. However, the situation eventually eased for the 2nd Canadian Division when US forces went on the offensive. Throughout the first week of August, significant German resources were transferred from the Anglo-Canadian front to that of the US 3rd Army, under Lieutenant General George Patton, while reinforcements moved from Pas-de-Calais to the Falaise-Calvados area. By August 7, 1944, only one major formation, the 12th SS Panzer Division at Lerjugend, faced Canadian forces on Verrier's Ridge. By August 1, 1944, the British had made significant gains on the Vire and Orne rivers during Operation Bluecoat, while the Americans had achieved a complete breakthrough in the west. On August 4, Simons and General Harry Crerar, newly appointed commander of the 1st Canadian Army, were given the order to prepare an advance on Falaise. 3 days later, with heavy bomber support, Operation Total Eyes began, marking the first use of Kangaroo armored personnel carriers. While the 3rd Canadian Infantry Division attacked east of the Seine Falaise Road, 2nd Division attacked to the west. By noon, Verrier's Ridge had finally fallen, and Canadian and Polish armor was preparing to exploit south towards Falaise. However, strong resistance by the 12th SS Panzer Division and the 272nd Volksgrenadier Division halted the advance. Although 12 kilometers of ground had been gained, Canadian forces had failed to reach Falaise itself. Simultaneously, the Germans had launched Operation Lüttich, a desperate and ill-prepared armor thrust towards Morton, beginning on August 6, 1944. This was halted within a day and, despite the increasingly dangerous threat presented by the Anglo-Canadian advance on Falaise, the German commander Field Marshal Gunther von Kluge was prohibited by Hitler from redeploying his forces. Thus, as American armored formations advanced towards Argentan from the south, the Allies were presented with an opportunity to encircle large sections of the German 7th Army. The 1st Canadian Army was ordered south, while the Americans prepared to move on Chambois on August 14. Simons and Crerar quickly planned a further offensive that would push through to Falaise, trapping the German 7th Army in Normandy. On August 14, the 1st Canadian Army launched Operation Tractable with the aim of capturing Falaise and achieving a link-up with American forces in Chambois. A daylight attack was executed after artillery provided smokescreen cover and medium bombers softened up the German defenses. The offensive was largely successful and, although the 2nd Division was not an active participant, divisional troops entered Falaise on August 16 as the remainder of 1st Canadian Army moved southeast towards Trun and Chambois. By August 21, the remnants of the battered German 7th Army had surrendered in the Falaise pocket, bringing the Battle of Normandy to a close. The German forces committed to Normandy since D-Day had been virtually annihilated. By the end of Operation Tractable, the 12th SS Panzer Division, the main adversary of the Canadians, had lost 80% of its tanks, 70% of its personnel carriers, and 60% of its artillery. Shortly afterwards, the 2nd Division moved to Forêt de la Lande, along the valley of the River Seine. From 27 to August 29, the 4th and 6th Brigades were engaged in heavy fighting against the rearguard of German forces seeking to withdraw across the Seine. Throughout September and October 1944, the 1st Canadian Army moved along the coast of France with the aim of securing the Channel ports. On September 1, while the 3rd Division made for Boulogne and Calais, the 2nd Division entered Dieppe, encountering virtually no resistance. 5 days later, they were tasked by Montgomery and Crerar with retaking Dunkirk. Heavy fighting around the outskirts would hold the division for several days, but, by September 9, the 5th Brigade had captured the port. The Dunkirk perimeter was handed over to the British on September 15, and the 2nd Division made for Antwerp. Although the Belgian White Brigade, the 11th Armored Division, and elements of the British 3rd Infantry Division had entered Antwerp as early as September 6, taking the city in docks, a strategic oversight meant that the nearby bridges over the Albert Canal were not seized, leaving the Germans in control of the scaled estuary. The failure to make an immediate push on the estuary ensured the strategically vital part would remain useless until the Scheldt was cleared. Strong formations of the German 15th Army, which had withdrawn from the Pas-de-Calais, were able to consolidate their positions on the islands of South Beveland and Walcheren, as well as the Albert Canal directly northwest of Antwerp, and were further reinforced by elements of General Kurt Student's 1st Parachute Army. During the initial phases of the battle, the 2nd Canadian Infantry Division sought to force a crossing of the Albert Canal. On October 2, the entire 1st Canadian Army, under the temporary command of General Simons, moved against the German defenses. 2 days later, 2nd Division had cleared the canal, and was moving northwest towards South Beveland in Walcheren Island. On Friday, October 13, later known as Black Friday, the 5th Brigade's Black Watch attacked positions near the coast, losing all four company commanders and over 200 men. 3 days later, the Calgary Highlanders conducted a more successful offensive, capturing the initial objective of Wonstrecht. Simultaneously, the 3rd Canadian Infantry Division and the 4th Canadian Division captured Bergen, cutting off South Beveland and Walcheren from reinforcement. By November 1944, the 1st Canadian Army had entered the Nijmegen Salient, which was being held for use in the development of future offensives. The 2nd Division came under the command of Major General Bruce Matthews, with Foulkes being transferred to command the I Canadian Corps on the Italian front. The 1st Canadian Army launched no major offensive operations from November 1944 to January 1945, the longest hiatus the Canadians had enjoyed since landing on the Normandy beaches the previous June. Operation Veritable was designed to bring the 21st Army Group to the west bank of the Rhine River, the last natural obstacle before entering Germany. Initially scheduled for December 1944, the operation was delayed until February by the German Ardennes Offensive. Plans were developed to breach three successive defensive lines, the outpost screen, a formidable section of the Siegfried Line running through the Hochwald Forest, and finally the Hochwald layback covering the approach to the ultimate objective of Sontern. The first phase began on February 8, 1945, with the 2nd Division's advance following up one of the largest artillery barrages seen on the Western Front. The Germans had prepared significant defenses in depth, both within the outpost screen and the Siegfried Line itself, and to add to the Canadians' difficulties, constant rain and cold weather obscured the battlefield. However, by the end of the first day, the 2nd Division had captured their objectives, the fortified towns of Weiler and Denhuvel. On February 11, the division moved southeast to assist British XXX Corps in their assault on Moyland Wood. The operational plan's second phase called for the 2nd and 3rd Divisions to take the Hochwald Forest. Following its capture, the 4th Canadian Armoured would sweep through the Hochwald Gap towards Wesel, followed by the 2nd Division leapfrogging towards Sontern. Operation Blockbuster was scheduled for February 27, but despite initial gains, stubborn German resistance prolonged the battle for 6 days. It was not until March 3 that the forest was cleared. During the intense close-quarter fighting, Major Frederick Tilston of the Essex Scottish Regiment won a Victoria Cross. Operation Blockbuster's final phase was the attack on Sontern itself, which lasted from 8 to March 10. This fell primarily to the 2nd Division and 2nd Canadian Armoured Brigade, although the 43rd Infantry Division was temporarily assigned to Simons' I Canadian Corps for the assault. Despite an elaborate preceding artillery barrage, strong German resistance caused the battle to degenerate into one of attrition. Because effective air support was prevented by fog and movement was hindered by German mortar barrages, the British and Canadians suffered heavy casualties. However, by March 10, the 2nd Division's 5th Brigade had linked up with elements of the 52nd Infantry Division, bringing the offensive to a close. Total Canadian casualties during Veritable and Blockbuster were 5,304 killed or wounded. As Canadian forces had incurred heavy casualties in clearing a path to the Rhine, the 2nd Division was excluded from the massive crossing operation that took place on March 23, 1945, instead crossing unopposed a week later after a bridgehead had been secured. After a brief detour through German territory, the 1st Canadian Army, now unified with the arrival of I Canadian Corps from Italian front, prepared to assault German positions in the Netherlands. The 2nd Division moved northwards towards Groningen. In the 9 days preceding their attack, German resistance had been light and uncoordinated, but opposition stiffened as the assault progressed, leading to heavy losses among the battalions of the 5th Brigade. By April 13, the division had been shifted eastward to guard the flanks of a British assault on Bremen, and the following day a Canadian corps liberated Arnhem. On May 2, the 2nd Division took Oldenburg, solidifying Canadian positions throughout the Netherlands. German and Canadian forces declared a ceasefire on May 5, and all fighting came to an end with the surrender of German forces in Western Europe on May 7, 1945. In October 1945, after 4 months in the Netherlands, General Order 52/46 officially disbanded the headquarters of the 2nd Canadian Infantry Division. By December, the entirety of the division had been stood down and returned to Canada. The division suffered heavy casualties through 1944 and 1945. According to Berkusen, it had the highest casualty ratio in the Canadian Army, from the time it returned to combat in early July 1944 until the end of the war. The following officers commanded the division.